Hi everybody! Hi Noga!
Hi Gil.
We have another psychoanalyzing video and another video in our three-part mini-series about people, characters with some Oedipal issues. And today we want to talk about Theon Greyjoy, the former prince of the Iron Islands, the would-be heir to that throne. And this guy, he has been through a lot. So when we talk about his traumas, where would you start?
He has daddy issues.
Elaborate, please.
His father gave him away physically. I mean, he had to. He was forced to do it because he lost the battle, but still, he didn't fight for him. And Greyjoy style.
Right.
But also he gave up on him emotionally.
Right. Because when... Because when he came back...
Bauble round your neck. Did you pay the iron price for it or the gold? Did you pull it from the neck of a corpse you made? Or did you buy it to match your fine clothes?
He ridiculed him.
It was like he was contaminated or something. You know, when he came back... Because he spent all that time with the Starks.
And he was coming in like expecting a parade.
The only living son of Balon Greyjoy. Me.
Iron or gold?
Gold.
He had a paper that gave to his father what his father supposedly wanted most, a throne. So he thought he would be greeted as a hero.
No man gives me a crown. I pay the iron price. I will take my crown. That is who we have always been.
You are worthless. You're not even my son. You're not my son.
That's harsh.
But he had a good father figure with Ned. An honorable guy, decent guy.
He had an honorable guy, decent guy, but he was his captor, you know? He also raised him among his other sons. And he always knew that he was different. He was like a second-class child of his.
These people are your people.
They are not my people.
Lord Stark raised you among his own sons.
Among them, but not one of them. I was his hostage, taken from my home.
Even John, his bastard son,
right,
was considered more of a...
Northerner.
A northerner than he is. He was a foreigner wherever he went. He didn't get his own direwolf, while all the other Stark children did.
Even John.
That one's yours, Snow.
I mean, it shows who belongs to the group and who doesn't.
But then he wanted to kill them. Right.
I think that he wanted to kill the Stark children. But
some Freudian shit confirmed right here. Right here. There's a shirt. There's a Freudian shit shirt. No. There's a Freudian shit confirmed shirt out there. Some of our viewers asked for it, so we're obliging. And you can see that straight at the beginning, in the first chapter in the books. After they execute the deserter from the Night's Watch, Theon is fucking playing football, soccer, with this guy's head. That's abhorrent behavior, which shows that Ned didn't really raise him, didn't educate him. You can't imagine Rob doing something like that. Ned would be like, are you fucking... Like, that kind of thing could not have happened because of years of education and telling his sons how they should be in the world.
You understand why I did it?
John said he was a deserter.
But do you understand why I had to kill him?
Our way is the old way.
Ned didn't teach him how to be a northerner.
Right.
His father didn't teach him how to be ironborn because he wasn't around.
He wasn't there.
He grew up like a wild weed, you know, somewhere, you know.
Like, he wasn't abused, but he was just like, whatever. Grow up. You'll get food. Everybody will be polite and nice to you. But just like nobody cares about you really emotionally.
I should have put a sword in your belly instead of in your hand.
You've served this house faithfully, old man. But keep talking and I'll...
So Ned is his capturer. So he's supposed to be like the bad guy in the story.
Well, but he's not a bad guy.
But he's not a bad guy because he's Ned Stark. And he's such a good guy. Yeah, he's such a great guy. So easy to love.
Right.
And you can't really hate him, because what will you hate? He's so honorable. He's always doing the great, the right thing.
I'm not a Stark, I know that. But your father raised me to be an honorable man.
Right, if you have a fight with Ned Stark...
Exactly, you're the asshole.
You're the asshole.
Ned is never the asshole. And that makes it really difficult to be angry with him.
And that's a problem?
And that's a problem, because if someone takes you away from your father... And he doesn't send you back. It's not as if Ned was like, oh, yeah, now the battle is over.
Right.
So you can go back to your friend. No, he's still keeping him like a trophy. And
hostage.
A hostage, exactly. On the one hand, he must be angry.
If he were alive to see this.
He's not. He's dead.
He must be angry at him. He must be angry at his father for not coming to get him.
Like, that would be healthy.
Yeah, that would be healthy. But instead, it's like a Stockholm syndrome. You know, it's like identifying with the aggressor in this sense. Ned is the aggressor, trying even to be liked and to be accepted.
Right. Him and Rob are best friends.
We can avenge him together.
Right. And it's so difficult because the ambivalence and the conflict must be so great there.
I'm a proven warrior.
Your brothers were warriors. Both of them dead. At the hands of those you seem so eager to protect.
So then he betrays his best friend.
I'm not protecting anyone. I'm a Greyjoy. I can't fight for Rob and my father both.
Tries to kill his best friend's brothers, right? Bran and Rickon.
Theon, did you hate us the whole time?
So at this point, he says, okay, I have this, I'm torn between these two cultures.
Mm-hmm.
One of honor and one of rape. I don't know. I don't want to judge. They're equally valid, right?
Of course.
It's culturally, I don't want to be culturally insensitive.
Yeah, exactly. It's relativism.
So, but on the other hand, he says, I'll go for the rape. I'll go for the rape. That's my... So he tries to be... an Ironborn, and even be a more Ironborn than Ironborn. He says, I will take Winterfell.
Please, Theon, think what you do.
We see how conflicted he is. He knows he's doing something wrong, you know.
He tries to hide it, and he goes too far.
You'll address me as Prince Theon, or you'll be next.
He tries to hide it, but he does it anyway because he really craves his father's acceptance and love. He's really tragic in that sense. And we always feel, I always feel, and you confirmed it, you also always feel, a bit uncomfortable when it comes to him. Because nothing is ever complete, you know, nothing comes together. It's always like this feeling of maybe I'm doing something wrong here. Never really comfortable.
It's always off.
Always off.
He's like the loser who tries too hard.
Right.
God's help you, Theon Greyjoy. Now you are truly lost.
Singing in the rain, just singing in the rain. What a glorious feel, and I'm happy again.
So in a way, he always stays that little boy that was taken from his family.
Never grew up.
He never matures. He never becomes a man. Full man, like in the Valleys of the series, but also like the mature man that you would expect to find anywhere. Someone who is knows who he is.
Right. And he's like grinning all the time and just like this irreverent and cocky. Everything sucks. The world sucks. That's not very mature.
No, not very mature. He's like a teenager also, always wanted to get laid, no responsibility.
That's pathetic.
Playing war.
Teenagers are pathetic, except the teenagers that are watching us right now. You're awesome. We have to talk about some more of his traumas. I don't know how to say it, how to break it to you, but he was severely tortured. By someone who kidnapped him.
Sorry.
Him, like, really kidnapped him this time, not like the first time around.
How about your little finger? You don't use that for much, do you? No? Good.
Someone that wasn't passive-aggressive like Ned was, like, aggressive. Was tortured. Castrated. Emotionally tortured.
Reek! That's a good name for you.
How do you think he felt?
In this Oedipal series, we've mentioned the term castration anxiety. Mm-hmm. It's an anxiety. It's not supposed to come true. But if it does come true, like it did in Theon's case, then it could be the most devastating thing ever. Especially for Theon, who only succeeded when it comes to women, you know? That's what he was known for, etc.
Right.
His only place of victory around his other male
peers, right.
So it was also taken away from him. Of course, the emotional pain of it is being... The emotional pain of it is unbearable. Being tortured, especially the way he was, like you said, also emotionally and psychologically tortured and physically. He's broken down. And he also said that to Yara.
You broke me into 1,000 pieces.
It causes a kind of like a dissociative state. The psyche, in a way, can't remain whole. It stems from the radical objectification of being tortured. You know, people treat you as if you have no feelings, no pain.
No value.
Or the only value you have in their eyes or your only pain is something that they enjoy or something that they, you know, the information that you can provide or whatever. But it's really meant for them to demonstrate their power on you.
Right. It wasn't about information.
It wasn't about information. It was about revenge and just like plain sadism. Even that, like, it had no justification that one can say, okay, I'm now protecting this and that.
A toy.
So let's play a game.
A toy,
exactly. And that's completely devastating. Like, that's crushing.
Even more than the physical pain.
Even more than the physical pain.
Why?
Because people endure physical pain. I mean, if you look at also the Westerosi guys. The fighting is part of their routine.
Right.
But here, the physical pain and the context of the physical pain is unbearable. When you're in a fight, then you're both equals in a way, you know, and then someone loses, someone wins.
Right. Even Jamie, when he lost his hand, it didn't destroy him completely. He was able to recuperate from that.
Right. Lakoff and Johnson, two theorists who wrote a book called Metaphors We Live By.
Okay.
They said that the metaphors we use in our everyday language, we use them for a reason. The reason is because they reflect part of our psychological structure.
Okay, for example?
For example, we fall in love. It's like this feeling of falling in love. It means something, the fact that we use it as a metaphor.
Okay. Running into a brick wall.
Running into a brick wall. This feeling of like being, hit by...
Running into a brick wall.
Exactly. What else did you say? And you have many metaphors that describe a sense of dissociation. Some kind of like fragmentation.
I'm torn.
I'm broken. I'm disjointed. I'm crushed. I fell apart. All kinds of metaphors that we use in order to describe some kind of a mental state. And then mental state, a dissociation. It's what happens after a very serious traumatic event. It can also happen during complex trauma, what Theon basically had in his childhood, where he experienced trauma after trauma, like micro traumas.
Okay.
But they accumulated into a state of complex trauma that has to do with his identity. I mean, his lack of ability to form an identity. And this is like a major trauma, of course, when he went through with Ramsay.
Right, and Ramsay broke his identity.
It's all right. It's me. Yara.
You can't trick me. Tell him. Tell him you couldn't trick me.
I'm not tricking you, Theon. I'm saving
you. Not Theon. Reek here. Reek. My name is Reek.
The reason that he could do it and really like turn him into Reek is because he already had the platform for it. Like his problems with his identity that were formed in his early childhood.
Right. Who am I?
Do you know who I am?
Who am I? Am I a Stark? Am I a Greyjoy?
No, I'm a Reek.
Exactly. That was a fertile ground for Ramsay to form, to be able to inflict that major traumatic event of turning him into Reek. Because someone else, like Arya Stark, right, they try to break her into changing her identity. Losing her identity. But she was so implanted in that identity, it was so strong that doesn't matter, I mean, the wave and other traumas she went through.
Right, she traumatized, but she is still Arya Stark.
Finally, a girl is no one.
She wasn't broken.
She wasn't broken.
A girl is Arya Stark of Winterfell.
And Theon was completely broken because he was cracked from before.
Right. Also, I think that being castrated here, it was also symbolic because the castration led to his political castration. Mm-hmm. Now he's not worth anything. He can't marry anyone. He can't continue the line of the Greyjoys. Before he was castrated even, he was a little bit impotent, metaphorically. Like, mm-hmm. there are other castrated people in the show, like Varys and the Unsullied, but they have this agency, they know what they're doing, they're mm-hmm. going somewhere. Mm-hmm. And he's just, like, aimless.
We can see that even when he tries to be potent, like when he tries to conquer Winterfell, he tries to lead those men, like those Iron Men, to follow him. Yeah. It's always off. It's always like this kind of, like, he can't really pull things off. Nothing really comes into existence.
Okay, so all these traumas, everything, the being torn and falling apart and broken. What kind of trauma, give me the bottom line, what kind of trauma it is?
Well, it's two kinds of traumas, really, because it's the complex trauma of his childhood. Mm-hmm. That was the fertile ground for the... what we later see as a PTSD, like a post-traumatic stress disorder. It was after Ramsay's torture, but it's really like his ability to, well, or lack of ability to regroup himself, right? Another metaphor we use, regroup, after the brokenness that he had experienced.
And we see this PTSD, he gets flashes of it again, when Euron basically unmans him, castrates him.
Ah, come on, you cockless coward.
Tells him, like, makes fun of him when he has Yara.
I have her. Come and get her.
You can see Theon, he's not there.
Right.
Something's happening.
Something's happening, and Yara can also see it.
Right. And then he flees. Mm-hmm. Which I thought was awesome, and I thought that was a very rational decision.
Right.
But just keep swimming.
Yeah.
But in the context of the show, the story, it was like a relapse. Mm-hmm, so mm-hmm. like PTSD, maybe you can explain why, how it never goes away.
Initially, it was named shell shock because they noticed that soldiers that come back from the war, they have these kind of symptoms that were not there before, like flashbacks and nightmares and problems sleeping. Sometimes depression and anxiety. Right.
Problems functioning in the world.
Problems functioning in the world, basically. And then we can also see that Theon was changed. Then at one point, when Yara told him, you need to decide whether you want to kill yourself or pull yourself together, another metaphor, then he decided to pull himself together. But we can see that with Euron, who is also a psychopath, just like Ramsay and the others, it triggered him very severely. He went back to Reek for that moment, like in front of Euron. It was like a transference of the feelings that he experienced with Ramsay. He was Reek, lacks agency, lacks sense of self.
Right, and he can't fight back. That's why I think he was rational, maybe inadvertently, mm-hmm. because he was losing. There was nothing he could do. He was mm-hmm. powerless, he was before.
In those situations, the person goes back into the same traumatic situation, like being helpless again, not feeling they have any control over the situation.
Right.
And that's sometimes arguable because sometimes people do have control, but because of PTSD, they experience themselves as if they don't.
So let's take this broken guy and put him on the couch and try to help him. So there are a few limitations here when we talk about his therapy because the writing on the show this past season has been less than stellar, specifically for Theon. But basically what happens later is that he...
Oh, yeah! funny?
Goes to save Yara. So that shows some agency on his part.
Yes, and before that, he had a conversation with John. It's as if John gave him his approval as a Stark, well, as a, the son of Ned Stark.
Not even that, right?
Not
yeah.
even that, of course, but they both don't know right. it at that point. That he doesn't have to have only one, like, single identity.
Because John doesn't have one.
For Theon, it was the approval of not thinking, who am I? I'm both.
Stark or Greyjoy.
You don't need to choose.
So after that, he just, like...
Priyara!
And then when he conquered that fear and conquered that, then everybody was with him. Yeah, Theon, we're all going to save Yara.
Something clicked inside. Like, before that, when he was trying to lead, it always felt like he can't really do it. Like, he can't pull it off.
Right.
Because inside, something wasn't right.
He didn't accept himself.
Exactly.
Also. Right, and here he says, I'm a cockless man. What you gonna do about it?
This time he could pull it off. Like, something inside was... complete, like right. It was yeah, exactly.
To the point,
yeah.
Not all over the place.
Yeah. Theon lost his sense of agency when he was weak, but he still had like a small Theon inside in a way. What stirred it up again was Sansa.
She reminded him of who he was before.
Exactly.
She didn't call him Rick, she knows he's Theon.
She knows he's Theon, and that was his... the kind of like wake-up call that he needed for little Theon. What remained of him. To fight back from the inside. And that's what made him also save her at that moment and save himself. Because otherwise he would have stayed with Ramsay.
Right.
And now with Euron, he's willing to confront his tormentor. It's not Ramsay himself, but...
It's the second best thing you can find.
Exactly.
Ooh, so how is that going to the source of your trauma?
Mm-hmm.
Deciding I will go there. Why? Because I want to save my sister. Maybe because his sister was the only one who accepted him for who he was and just offered him a place and a sense of belonging. Like, if he loses his sister,
mm-hmm.
then maybe he has nothing. He's, like, willing to risk everything. So I'm not sure it's like a good decision. I don't know, maybe he should do something else, but emotionally it feels more healthy.
It's as if by meeting with Sansa and Jon and Yara, it's like he's reacquainting himself with his different parts, you know? It's like, and right. Yara definitely was the only one who really accepted him for who he was. And she was the only one who tried to save him when his father
right.
gave up on him. She was right. still there.
So he's returning the favor.
Yeah. The only thing that can truly repair it is finding himself back as a subject, as an agent in this world that can do things, you know. He can make stuff happen.
So if it works,
then he will be rehabilitated right. in a way.
And even if it doesn't work... he was still a subject. He tried.
He tried.
He failed.
Mm-hmm. Like subjects do. We fail. We yes, try and we fail.
Yes, we do. We do. We hope we didn't fail in this video. So if you enjoyed the video, you should definitely click like and subscribe to get all our psychoanalyzing videos. So if you enjoy those, you should check out our Patreon page, patreon.com/GOTAcademy. So thanks for watching and we'll see you all next time. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in.